Did you know you could sponsor Nerd and Tie? That's right. This episode of Nerd and Tie, like all episodes of Nerd and Tie, are sponsored by listeners like you. You can either directly contribute to and sponsor an episode and have your name read aloud, or if you want to just kind of donate generally, we have a legal fund at GoFundMe.com/Nerd and Tie. Please consider giving if you can. On this episode of Nerd and Tie, we welcome our newest co-host, Gen Prock. The CW has renewed all of its DC Comics shows early. Constantine is returning in an animated form, but still starring Matt Ryan. Charmed is getting rebooted for God knows why. And the con scene is exploding with Awesome Games Done Quick raising a massive amount of money. Scott Windorski getting his butt kicked from Evercon for being creepy. Outlaw Comicon has gone insane on social network, and Phoenix Comicon will require their volunteers to pay dues, something like that, in English, and your mail, all here on Nerd and Tie. I kind of stumbled through that intro. Sorry about that. Welcome, folks, to Nerd and Tie, the only podcast out there with a dress code. I am, of course, one of your co-hosts, the Tradorn. Joining me, as always, although back into still picture mode due to problems with his camera, the stoic Nick Izumi.
I wish you guys could see. I have such a happy face right now, and it's killing me.
And
the camera.
And of course, our newest member of the team, the very animated Gen Prock.
Hello. It me.
Yes.
Yay.
And so we get to start out in this episode, of course, introducing you, the listener, to Gen, our newest teammate, the I don't know, the shortest member.
Technically, yes.
Yeah.
The definitely the most imposing when it comes to anything related to Tolkien, quite frankly.
Now, obviously, you know, when we were replacing Fur, it was very hard shoes to fill, but we did manage to find our first friend who had thick-rimmed glasses, of course. Because
ones that I don't, like, are not fake and I don't wear contacts with.
Yeah. I was going to tell you guys, Fursters is the weirdest human being in the world for one reason, in that he puts on contact lenses and then puts on fake glasses. We have attempted to tell him many times that there is an easier way to do that where he could skip a step, but that's between him and his ophthalmologist and God and not us. So, yes, Gen Prock. Gen is, Gen, tell us a little bit about yourself.
I currently reside in Plover, Wisconsin, which is just south of Stevens Point. It's in the very middle of the state. I work part-time in retail and also work on my personal business of crafting stuff and selling it. I have an Etsy store, Society 6 store. I run around to different conventions and do artist alleys and stuff like that. I'm most known for my pillows. I love my Banff, my cat Banff, who you will find on my Instagram a lot. If you just like Google Ocelot Dude, that's my handle, and that's where you'll find me on everywhere. I have a boyfriend of 6 years who I love very much.
So nobody
hit
on her.
I have a second stomach for ice cream, and I love Ray Bradbury, Isaac Asimov, and J.R.R. Tolkien as my favorite authors.
I reiterate, absolutely the scariest person to try doing Tolkien trivia with. You will
not
win.
Really.
You will embarrass yourself. It's just terrible.
Come on, I'm only halfway through the Unfinished Tales. Come on.
You read the Silmarillion as light reading again. Come on.
And Narn and Handurin.
I've never made it past the middle of Two Towers.
I prefer them on audiobook. I highly recommend the audiobooks of The Lord of the Rings.
Well,
I second that.
As a child, my parents read The Hobbit to me out loud. It's kind of the same thing.
Well, and that's because it it's a kid's book. Appropriate.
I love that book. I don't want to get too distracted by that. I'm always blown away by your, like, Tolkien knowledge. It always makes me really happy.
Well, and it brings a level of expertise that no one else on the show really has. So I think that's actually going to be helpful going forward for all of those additional Tolkien movies that are coming out.
I'd also say Gen's kind of our gaming guru for stuff out right now.
Oh, cause... yeah, I'm really into Let's Plays and video games and stuff, so I'll be bringing a lot of that to the table on this side as well.
Does Eric know that he just entered a shot?
Looks like a really good soda, but you were in the shot.
I mean, technically only his arm was, but...
He was showing me some blue raspberry soda he got. It looks really good.
Audio listeners, of course, heard nothing, and we just started digressing because I'm looking at Gen's camera feed, and I see... I see a DJ
delicious,
walk in.
Delicious.
Anyways... So, you know, it's funny, like, there's so much stuff that's been going on these last couple of weeks because we, you know, I don't expect, like, there's so much stuff that we're not going to cover in the show that I wish we had more time for, like, where the Nintendo Switch reveal was such a big deal, and then, like...
I haven't been this frustrated. I can't afford a new system since when the PS2 came out.
Yeah. Right? And, like, there's so much stuff that we have, like, we're not going to cover this episode, and I'm really sorry about that. But we should move into things that we are excited about. And, Gen, you know, I don't know about you, but I know me and Nick are really excited about this first piece of news.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it is exciting, because last week, the CW announced that it was renewing... a bunch of their shows, including all of their DC properties.
Yay!
So we get, which is so exciting. So we get more Supergirl, Flash, Arrow, Legend of Tomorrow, as well as some non-DC stuff, including like Supernatural and Jane the Virgin.
Which
and
are both very
just...
good. Well, Jane the Virgin, I'm very happy is getting more another season. Supernatural, I watch every episode, but man,
where can it go?
Like
really,
think about
seasons?
It. Think about it. Since Supernatural premiered, both Gilmore Girls and Veronica Mars have been canceled and gotten revivals.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
They were contemporary shows.
Yeah. Just wait until Supernatural like season 45, where they're both like wheeling around in their wheelchairs with their shotguns.
Well,
like...
I'll tell you, Eric Kripke has said that they will keep doing Supernatural as long as the network keeps renewing them and Jared and Jensen are still willing to do it.
Oh, and they'll be willing to do it for such a long time.
Let's remember that
they
this
love
is
hanging out.
Let's remember this is a show that was meant to end after its fifth season.
Jeez.
They finished the show after five seasons.
Yeah,
and they were done.
But then again, Arrow was supposed to only be five seasons long, and now they're kind of having to rework that, because the original idea was that the last episode of season five was going to end on the same scene that the first episode of season one started on, which was Oliver on the island starting the fire to get help. And yeah, and... I guess we're getting a sixth season of Arrow.
Which means they'll have to start flashing back to season one. Right?
Yeah.
Because that's how it's worked, right?
I'm a little bit worried about Arrow. And, I mean, which is weird coming from me, Arrow guy for the longest time.
Well,
I still love it, but...
I'm going to say the following things about Arrow. What they're going to have to do is rework the show. It's because... Or, you know, have some other characters who need flashbacks from their time before the series, because it's the journey, Oliver Queen's emotional journey from that first season seems to be, like, completing as his change as a person over this, like, because it's a five season, over the five seasons, we've seen 10 years of this guy's life and kind of his evolution throughout those years, but, I think that they're just going to have to change. I mean, and it's clear that those same writers are doing, like, Supergirl and The Flash and Legends of Tomorrow. So, I mean, really, it's just that removing that flashback aesthetic from the show wouldn't be super difficult and still make it feel like Arrow. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I think the other I think you're exactly right. They're going to need to rework it, especially since if they're going to keep doing these crossovers, and they want to keep doing these crossovers, they're going to need to come up with more ways to make Oliver relevant to the situation. Because...
Well, I mean, what they can just do is have a bad guy. You know, believe it or not, you can just sometimes have a bad guy.
Mm-hmm.
You know... I mean, I understand that, like, the Flash is really bad about not having it be a speedster. I gotta say, I was so disappointed when Alchemy turned out not to be the major big bad.
But because we have yet another super evil speedster.
Well, and it's not one established from the comics. Like, it's not like they made up. It's just they're gonna run out of evil Flash antagonists who are speedsters eventually.
Well,
and that's when we get the trickster season.
It's frustrating for me because, like, if you look at Flash lore, for the longest time, believe it or not, as awesome as Reverse Flash is, a lot of having Eobard Thawne be Barry's ultimate enemy was kind of a retcon on Geoff Johns' part. Because for even Captain Cold being Barry's ultimate bad guy is kind of a retcon, because Mirror Master was like Flash's arch nemesis for a very long time, and now Mirror Master was only just introduced, and they're not really making him final boss material yet.
Yeah, well, but there's still time to develop. I think that the Flash I'm not worried about. I just think it's funny that, you know, it's like I understand the structure of the Flash. They want a season-long big bad a la Buffy, and that's fine. And it's just, you know, eventually they're going to run out of speedsters. I mean, I guess they can bring back Black Flash now, you know.
Yeah, but I don't know.
But no, what I'm saying is, like, eventually they're going to hit season 5 and just be like, okay, Captain Boomerang got better.
I would love to see them do a season that embraces just the rogues teaming up to do something great. I love the rogues when they're at their silliest. And I wish they would bring in more of the silliness that came with the rogues. Like Captain Cold having his policies that everyone needs to follow. Like, if you're going to be a member of the rogues, you need a costume. If you don't have a costume, go see this tailor. He'll get you a costume.
So, in other words, do Buffy season 6.
Sure, yeah.
With the nerds, yeah.
I sincerely mean that. That would
I'm controversially saying that that's actually my favorite season. Like, I know it's not like not everybody agrees with me, but that's like my favorite Buffy season. But. 4 and 6 are my two favorite seasons, and it puts me in such a minority in the fandom for that. But the CW, this really, just to pull us back to the core of the story, the CW renewing all these shows, the only shows effectively that ran this fall that CW did not renew are Vampire Diaries, because that's already, like, announced to be its final season. So no one was expecting anything other than, you know, like, it's running its final season, so that's fine. And then the other two shows are No Tomorrow and Frequency. Literally everything else on the network got renewed, and Frequency and No Tomorrow both didn't receive back orders, like, to fill out the rest of their season. So,
oh
dear. Effectively, the CW renewed all but two of their shows, and the only two shows that they didn't renew are the ones that no one's surprised, because, and it's really too bad, because No Tomorrow is really good. I'm really enjoying that. But it just didn't catch on the way, like, some of their other romantic comedy shows like Jane the Virgin and, you know, Crazy Ex-Girlfriend did. So it's probably going to go away.
Cool. I've never watched it.
Frequency's got a better shot because it's getting really good replay online. So there's still technically hope for Frequency to get renewed, but I haven't watched a single episode of it myself. So it's hard to say. This is actually, though, really weird. If neither Frequency nor No Tomorrow get picked up, it's going to be the first time that the CW, in at least in as far as I can think of, hasn't picked up any of their freshman shows from the fall. I mean, mind you, they only had two. Everything else was a returning show in the fall. But Like, it would be, it is fairly remarkable. I mean, it doesn't help that most of their lineup was returning from the previous year. So it's, and obviously Legends of Tomorrow is moving to Tuesdays into No Tomorrow's time slot once the No Tomorrow episodes play out, which is going to be weird because we're going to get two superhero shows on one night, which also means that we're going to have three superhero shows across television on that night between Flash, Legends of Tomorrow, and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Man, for those of us who watch everything the next day online,
yeah,
I'm
going to
have a very busy Wednesday. And Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. has actually gotten really good this season, so I don't want to, like, downplay that. But, those are... You know, speaking of the Arrowverse, Nick...
Yeah. We actually have some more good news from the Arrowverse. Not exactly the good thing I was hoping for, but still good. Everyone knows that Constantine was one of my favorite TV shows from a couple of years ago.
For the visual of you cosplaying
Trey and I
him.
Were both... Yeah, there's the... For anyone watching the video feed, there's me cosplaying John Constantine. Love the character. Love him in Swamp Thing. Love him on his own. Hellblazer all the way. Trey and I called it the best show of that new season and that it still got canceled.
Did I?
Well, yeah. You and I both were in Constantine's corner and Fur voted for The Flash.
Oh, yeah. I forgot what year that was.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That was the thing that happened. Yeah. Obviously, one of those shows is still going. Matt Ryan has been really cool about it. We got him to... Constantine became part of the Arrowverse when we got the crossover episode on Arrow, including scratching his butt with a peacock feather, which was nice.
And he was wearing his original costume from the show because they literally just shipped it up to Vancouver out of a closet.
Which is fantastic. You know, it was a nice nod. It was a nice continuation. We've gotten some nods that Constantine is still running around in the Arrowverse. Last we heard from Oliver, he was literally in hell.
Yeah.
And now, much like Vixen did before him, he is getting a animated series on the CW Seed. Yes, the animated Constantine, the animated series on CW Seed. So online streaming, and it's going to be, you know, like 6 10-minute episodes, but it's still more Matt Ryan as Constantine. So
it's really like getting like one new Constantine episode a year.
Uh-huh.
Well, and that's actually going to be the third end because they've got the Ray coming out also.
Mm-hmm. But it's very... I'm mostly excited.
It's Gen yawns.
Sorry.
No, it's cool.
I think it's exciting because it maintains his presence in the universe, and it's really like obviously like there's some weird stuff with those animated series of where they fit in the timeline because like Vixen season 2 takes place prior to her appearance on Arrow.
Okay, well that's okay. I can deal with that.
Yeah, well, which is why you know say Laurel Lance shows up in Vixen season 2. And things that happen in the Arrow episode are actually reference the events of Vixen season 2 a little bit.
Okay, like, I actually haven't watched Vixen yet. I'm sorry.
Okay,
I'm meaning to.
Well, no, but like, so if you take that episode of Arrow where Vixen appears, she and Laurel Lance appear to have like a little bit of a bond and like seem to know each other, even though there's no established point of them meeting each other in the first season of Vixen.
Right.
That happens in the second season of Vixen, which only came out now. So it
That's
takes place.
That's cool then.
The timeline's really complicated.
It's been nice to see Matt Ryan embrace this character, though. I mean, next month, the animated Justice League Dark movie is coming out.
Yeah, that was originally supposed to come out last month, and so it's like, they're taking forever on that.
I'm still excited for it. I've already been promised the limited edition as a early birthday present from a friend, so that'll be exciting.
Yeah, but it's
maybe
nice.
Maybe I'll post a review on the site.
Yeah, it's nice we're getting a canonical reappearance of him because obviously that Justice League Dark is a different reality than the established continuity. And so the fact that we get more of the canonical, you know, John Constantine from the Arrowverse is, you know, definitely awesome.
The other bonus that I just thought of, and I don't want to dwell on this too long so we can move on to the other stories, but the other bonus about doing it animated is that it means a lot of the weird magic DC characters can be done without having to worry about a TV budget.
Right.
So, you know,
right.
Yeah, so Swamp Thing could cameo.
Right. It's assuming that
Etrigan
they can get permission
cameo.
To use them. But Etrigan, right. What didn't Etrigan already show up?
Not Etrigan, but the Spectre. They were setting up for the Spectre on Constantine, the main show.
No, I meant on Arrow.
I don't think so.
I'm Googling.
If he did, I don't recall Etrigan showing up. If I did, I feel terrible that I forgot Etrigan, because I love Etrigan. Gone, the form of man.
I could be wrong. I could be totally wrong, and maybe I dreamt it, but, you know, like...
Well, there was another guy whose last name was Blood. You had Brother Blood, but not Jason.
That's probably what I'm thinking of.
But, yeah, this is still very exciting, and I'm just very happy, because...
Yeah, I'm sorry. It's my brain went to the wrong Blood.
Because we'll be getting, yeah, we can get, maybe we will even get a follow-up with what happened to Jim Corrigan, because that would be fun, right? Anybody, look, I'm really happy about this. Nothing is going to ruin it for me.
Well, we know that by the time he showed up on Arrow, he was traveling alone.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, like, there's a lot of gaps for, you know, like, we don't know what happened between Constantine, like, the series, and his appearance on Arrow.
Yeah, maybe that Brujeria stuff got sorted out.
Yeah,
maybe.
No. Honestly, they may just do that. You know, like...
I would love to have that sorted out.
Just cut forward and new stories. I think what they're just going to do is just jump forward, new stories. And because even though they've put the entire Constantine series up on the CW seed for free to watch, like... I'd rather the new show just kind of jump in and not require you to know new viewers to know the full acknowledge the continuity. Acknowledge the continuity. Like, it's there. It totally happened, but we aren't going to tell you what happened. We're just starting from here and going forward.
Like, but shout out to my fellow Hellblazers anyway, because we got a physical home video release of Constantine. Not often that a show that only had one season and got canceled early gets DVD release, so I'm going to celebrate it.
That's true. Like, there are so many shows that I can't get on DVD. I can't get Invisible Man Season 2. It's on Hulu.
We did it, Hellblazers. We did it.
So,
anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, we should look at what else the CW is doing, because that's our theme this episode.
Apparently, yeah, this whole episode is the CW and conventions, because, let me tell you, the CW just has done some amazing things, but not everything the CW does always makes sense. And let me tell you, so there's this little show in the 90s and early 2000s called Charmed. It had an amazing cover of a Smith song as an opening theme that attempted to tell you that a show starring all women was The Son and the Heir, S-O-N and H-E-I-R, which was confusing enough. It not only tried to jump on the Buffy bandwagon,
oh dear.
It also decided to jump on the craft bandwagon and misinform a generation of youngsters about what my religion is. That's right, I'm talking about Charmed.
I'm so sorry.
I hate this show so much. Which, it ran from 98 to 2006, and it was never really good. It was watched. Charmed has its fans, and I'm sure a couple of them are going to be mad at me and throw rocks at me, but, man, it is inconsistent. Character arcs, inconsistent powers, and a total disregard for its own internal mechanics whenever the plot was convenient. because, again, Aaron Spelling said, I want to get me some of that sweet, sweet Buffy money. And that was charmed. But, you know, there is an episode that features Dishwalla as key to the center of the plot. So, you know, that happened.
I have a Dishwalla CD.
Tell me all your thoughts on God. Because I'm on my way to see her.
I don't even know where it came from.
Ask her why. And I was a teenager in the 90s. I'm allowed to know every line of that song. Anyways, we bring this up because the CW, in all of their wisdom, has decided to reboot Charmed in the most confusing way possible. You see, they're going to reboot Charmed, but it's not going to be about the Hollowell sisters. So none of your, and it's not a remake with the like new people playing the original sisters. So no original cast, not even the characters with new people. But it's going to actually not be set in current times like the original show was set at its current time. It's going to be set in the 1970s. Now, is this a prequel? Is this a prequel? Not according to the CW. In fact, according to the CW, this will be a separate continuity, but we're still setting it in the 1970s. And the only thing I could think of is they want some of that sweet, sweet Stranger Things money this time around.
Yep.
Which had an early 80s aesthetic, so late 70s is close enough for government work and the CW. So... Now the only good news is that the show, this is still in development. It has not been picked up. This is still early development, and the show is being penned by Jessica O'Toole, Amy Rarden, and Jenny Snyder, who all work on Jane the Virgin, which Jane the Virgin's super good. But I'm going to tell you, this is still Charmed, and the only good thing about Charmed is the cover of the Smiths' How Soon Is Now by Love Spit Love that was used as the opening. And let me tell you, if you watch that on streaming on Netflix right now, there's, my God, what is that?
What happened?
I don't know. That wasn't me.
That was scary.
Apparently, the CW is coming to get us. So. I just want to point, so you could hear that on the show, the little thrumming noise. That was not in my studio. I don't know about you two. It sounded like a truck.
Yeah, it wasn't coming from here, though.
It might have been a truck outside of my apartment because the walls are thin.
Okay. So
I apologize.
No, it's okay. I think it's funny timing. So anyways, Charmed is totally coming back. In the, like, most, of course, craven opportunist way possible, which, of course, makes it Charmed. Now, I will say, like, the only, you know what, and now you may be saying to yourself, Trey, Charmed can't be as bad as you're saying it is. I remember it fondly. I watched every single episode. In the last year, I have rewatched the entirety of Charmed. And I will tell you that Netflix version loses the How Soon Is Now opening, which, of course, ruins the whole show. Not as bad as Birds of Prey losing the, Amy Allen Revolution because they like replaced it with like soft rock on the streaming version, which is weird. But
I can vouch for that. I didn't see the original opening till I looked it up, and when you told me there was an original opening, and
Birds
it changes the tone drastically.
Yeah, at least with the kind of stock music replacement for How Soon Is Now, they tried to pick something that matched the sound of How Soon Is Now to go with the visuals, but like. No, it's they couldn't pay for the Love Spit Love cover for the streaming version. So let me tell you, Charmed is bad. Don't even get me started on the horrific episode where Prue turns herself into a dude and they're down pitching Shannen Doherty's voice. And also, why in season 2 does Prue suddenly want to become a photographer? There are like no seeds of that in the entire first season. And she has this whole setup where she's like an antique. You don't like spend that many years of your life becoming like an expert in antiques and then just go, I want to be a photographer. Like, sorry.
I've never seen this show.
Why does Phoebe get to levitate? Her powers are precog. Why does Prue get astral projection when her powers are moving things with her mind? Shouldn't those go the other way around? In the advancement of development? Piper's the only consistent character across the whole series. Piper is the only consistent character across the whole series.
I think my wife watched some of it. But
and don't even get me started about the neighbor boyfriend they introduced at some point, and like they wrote out his daughter like immediately.
This sounds like a masterpiece of terribility.
God damn it, CW, why are you bringing back Charmed?
Because someone had to do it. I can't even say that with a straight face.
I mean... Well, it's I don't understand it on so many levels, because it's not just that they're bringing back Charmed, but they're doing it as a prequel that... Not a prequel. They're doing it set in an earlier time period, but separate from the continuity.
Charmed, like, the not prequel prequel.
Pretty much.
Although, if you ever want to see a really young Misha Collins, he isn't an episode. So is John Cho in a random episode.
That's weird.
Mark Shepard makes an appearance as a demon. He sells, buys people's souls.
Oh, dear God.
I feel like there's a missed opportunity for a crossover. But it's... like,
oh, dear God.
Like, there's so many random, like, guest stars on that show because it ran for so long. But, oh, my God, like, no, don't. Hopefully this will all just die on the vine. You know, it's like. This is not
you
something we need, CW. Charmed happened to us once. It doesn't need to happen to us again.
Oh, dear God.
If you want to stop Charmed, please write your local CW affiliate. And tell them, please, don't bring back Charmed.
There must be... Tell me, is there some hope somewhere? Oh, man.
Oh, we should move on? I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know how much else we could talk about Charmed, you know.
Find me some shred of emotion, spirit, please. Show me something good.
Well, I've been kind of quiet for the past two things because I don't really watch too much TV. For the past week, I've actually been watching Awesome Games Done Quick, which is a week-long marathon of speedrunning video games. Run for charity.
Yeah.
And this has been the most fructitious marathon they've ever done, raising over $2 million for Prevent Cancer Foundation, which is crazy. It's the most money they've made in the past, like, 7 years they've been doing this across their 14 marathons, like, this is awesome. This is so great. I can't wait to see where they go.
I'm so jazzed to hear about how well that did.
Yeah.
I only watched parts of it, and actually, it was because of your boyfriend again. I was hanging out on my computer, and then suddenly, Jen's boyfriend is like, "Hey, Nick, Awesome Games Done Quick is going to do Cardcaptor Sakura Tetris."
Yes, like, I remember seeing that.
I didn't even know that was a thing.
Yeah, and they speed ran it as a race between two people. It was great.
You know, it's and actually, some of the people who help with that are World 9 Gaming, who are friends of the show. Yep. And, you know, they ran our video game room when we did the Nexpo. Yes. Mm-hmm. Awesome Game. It's a really incredible thing that they do, and it's, you know, it's a massive event. It's the sort of thing I would love to go to if, like, I didn't have, like, a job.
Well, actually, because Awesome Games Done Quick, which is usually run around this time, they also have Summer Games Done Quick in the summer, obviously, but Awesome Games Done Quick is ran in... Virginia, mostly. Virginia, yep. D.C., Maryland, or, it's been. But Summer Gaming Done Quick is actually ran in Minneapolis, Minnesota.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Both of those are equidistant for me. Being in Indiana.
Yeah. But you can catch their week-long live stream on Twitch. And you can donate if you can or want to. They have awesome prizes that they give away during the whole week that you can donate for. And they also have game incentives, which is really cool.
Yeah.
I'm so... What I saw of Awesome Games Done Quick, it was... The Awesome Games is on two... The Awesome is on two levels, because the games that they were playing were legitimately good and really entertaining games to watch people play.
Yeah.
And it was... Their hosts were all so great, and I learned a ton about gaming history and about the games themselves while I was watching, and all the work they did for charity. It was just a double whammy of good things. It was just entirely just goodness.
Yeah.
Concentrated goodness.
Yeah, and $2 million is a lot of money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hobisky.
Yeah, and they made it handily. Like, in the, because we were watching on the last day, and like in the middle of the day, it was just like, oh, it's over a million. Awesome. Cool. And then they started talking like, oh, if we can make it to two. And then it got down to the very last game being ran, and it was Undertale. And one of the incentives was how to deal with the final boss of Undertale. You could bid to go either way. And like, it just shot so fast. It shot up so fast and so much. Like, they hit it easily at that point. It was so crazy. Like, there are so many people out there who just, like, want to help and want to donate and want to, like, see good.
And seeing nerddom just... actively doing good. That's
that's
awesome.
That's amazing.
Definitely.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, and, like, the runs that they do are so impressive. I watched a guy complete Super Bomberman in 15 minutes. Not lying.
That's so cool. That's so,
right?
That's so cool.
That's pretty
Contra
amazing.
3, 6 minutes. It's insane. Like, because these are guys that, like, dedicate themselves to speed running these games and finding the glitches, and it's just so impressive what they do. And it's so cool.
Can I give a challenge to our listeners and to nerd culture at large inspired by this?
Mm.
Nerd culture, let's make Awesome Games Done Quick. Let's make that the tone we want to set for the rest of 2017. Let's do as much good as we can while being as awesome as we can possibly be. Let's be like that show. Let's set the turn. Let's let that set the tone for nerddom for the rest of the year. I would love to see that.
Yeah.
We need to balance out the bad.
Yeah, because there's a lot of bad out there.
There's going to be a lot of it, so we got to...
Yep.
God. Oof. But, you know, it's good to see people, like, doing things successfully for charity. So I'm happy about that. It's, you know, I don't know if there's a good way to transition to our next story besides...
Say, now I have to go back to sad mode.
But while we're going to go back to sad mode, let us at least, before we start, acknowledge that the convention we're going to talk about did everything right in response to badness.
This is true.
These guys are great.
So this last weekend, both Gen and I were at Evercon for Evercon's 17th year. They have every other year they have been hosted at the DC Everest Middle School in the Rothschild Wausau area. And this year they moved to the formerly Patriot Center, now Central Wisconsin Convention Center, in Wausau, or technically in Rothschild. Anyway,
for all intents and purposes, if you're not from Wisconsin and you want to find out where this was on a map, it was Wausau.
It was, yeah. We'll just say Wausau. Evercon is one of the best organized cons in the state, especially, I mean, it is a small gaming con where half of it's organized by the middle schoolers, and it's better organized than a lot of cons I've seen run by college kids, and that continued into this year. Which is pretty amazing considering that the story we're about to relay to you was completely freaking bonkers.
Yeah.
In the artist alley here, or in the artist alley and vendor area, they had a lot of great people from the area. Gen's table included, my wife's table included, Bal Flanagan's table, a lot of really great people. Unfortunately, we also ended up meeting another fellow who goes by the shop name of Naughty Cobbler, aka Scott Windorski. Windorski
I'm holding up Windorski's photo for people at home.
Windorski sells a lot of homemade wooden notebooks and wooden frames. Unfortunately, he also was making a habit as basically from, not even basically, only a few hours into the con of going around and creeping out the other artists, mostly the apparently female artists. Or at least artists who could perceivably be seen as female.
Right, we understand.
Right. Windorski went around through the entire around just saying creepy things, generally making artists uncomfortable, and this was not kosher. This was not sitting well, but things came to a breaking point when he stopped by the table of Brittany Smith, aka Acute Castle, who's very talented artist from our area.
Yeah, and this is her first show vending just on her own. She used to vend as part of Pinstripe's studio, I should say. I remember to pluralize that because there's so many things called Pinstripe on the internet.
Smith was doing her normal thing, selling her art. Apparently, Windorski had commissioned her at another show in the past and wanted to thank her for that. And then it started going into creepy territory. I'm going to kind of abridge this because I wrote a very, very long and I think exhaustive article.
It's the article that broke our website for a day.
Which and even that article is pretty heavily truncated, just to give you an idea of how much insanity we bore witness to over that weekend.
And continue to
even now. Windorski, among other things, started asking about Smith's skin condition, where she apparently had eczema. When she explained that that's what it was, Windorski then told her that he would like to see her naked. Smith informed him that was a step over the line and was unacceptable, and that she didn't want to talk to him, so he left the table.
Yeah, pro tip, don't tell strangers that you want to see them naked. Just don't.
Don't do it.
I mean, unless it's a weird thing, like they're an artist model there to apply for an artist model job.
Right?
Or like
you're a professional like skin painter and you have a model coming in.
Or if they're literally applying to work in pornography, I guess that would be the other situation. Yeah. But not
when it's just someone who, you know, is trying to sell their art.
Right.
You know?
Right. Not someone doing a typically clothed activity who you've never met before.
At an event run by middle schoolers.
Yeah.
There were so many children there.
So many children there. So, Windorski returned later, and instead of just saying excuse me or talking to Smith, proceeded to throw dollar bills at her to get her attention. She told him in what she described as her teacher voice to pick them up and do it again, but that didn't dissuade him from staying at the table. It was then that Smith sought security for help. Security, who was represented by Brett B., who has asked that we not disclose his real name for reasons we'll get to later, heard from both Smith and other artists about Windorski's behavior and immediately removed him from the con. See, that's one of the reasons why Evercon knows what they're doing. They have a clearly written harassment policy and a zero tolerance policy.
And Brittany was actually, Brittany was unaware of this, but she's not the first person to, she was, like, he had literally just been reported by someone else beforehand as well.
Mm-hmm.
Like, this was, this was, multiple people were made uncomfortable by this man, and his behavior towards, to Brittany Smith was just even worse.
Mm-hmm. That was just the pinnacle of it. We would find out, Smith would find out later, after he started sending her messages on social media, that he was posting pictures of her without permission.
Like,
and making,
say this one that he posted to Facebook, mm-hmm. that she was unaware that he had taken.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that. And he proceeded to start making some really bizarre claims, like that he had gotten kicked out of the event because he had a date with Smith. Something that Smith had never promised him and would had no interest in.
Yeah.
Because she was scared of him.
Yeah, he claimed that he had a date with her, and that the most bizarre thing to me is also that he began to claim that, and this is the reason why Brett does not want his last name revealed, is that he began to claim repeatedly online that the real reason he had been kicked was because Brett, who he would only refer to as the Kilt. I'm 100% certain that Windorski has no idea what Brett's name is. He would.
I'm also certain of this. Put it in the article.
He would refer to the Kilt as having sent him previously had sent him dick pics, and that there had been some sort of online flirtation through Craigslist that had been unwelcome, and that the whole reason why he had been kicked was because of some sort of rejection. Now, this doesn't make any sense.
To mention Windorski's story of this rejection and this Craigslist thing, the details were constantly changing.
Yes, they have been constantly changing as he continues to modify the story, as he would then
and they're
also
still changing.
Yeah, like they are literally still changing. And so, like, this whole thing is so nuts. Even after, like, you know, it's we know for a fact, and we have spoken, like, Nick directly spoke to women, and I've spoken to some of the people in, you know, since then who were harassed by him. Multiple people reported him for harassment. Most importantly, Brittany, who he repeatedly claimed really, like, wanted to still see him, and he still has made claims, like, to this degree, like, throughout the last week on social media that, you know, let that go through your head, that even if we repeatedly tell him that, no, she reported you, she doesn't want any contact with you, he refuses to actually acknowledge this.
The weirdest part was when we sought him out for a statement, he has claimed that we were misusing Brittany or using her for hits, even though she asked me personally at the event to do the article that I wrote.
Yeah, it's Brittany.
He
has repeatedly claimed that the staff approached Brittany to, like, try to talk her into getting him kicked out, which is not true remotely. He has made very strange statements on his Facebook page about gender fluid artist Belle Flanagan,
mm-hmm.
in the most weird, insane ways. Like, I mean, like, really weird ways that make no sense. He keeps changing his story to match whatever facts, and, like, he will now, like, now in his justifications, he's including events that happened in Twitter arguments post-convention as reasons why he got kicked out during the convention. Like, just let you boggle that for a minute. Apparently, a conversation he had with someone 3 days after the convention on Twitter is why he got kicked out.
Mm-hmm. No, it's been very nuts. It's been very creepy. Again, I cannot emphasize enough, this has continued to get weirder both while I was writing the article and well after. There were a lot of points where I had to consider what to put in and what not to put in, just because of what a tangled web of insanity this has been.
Well, the funny thing is, while you were writing that article, like, during the convention, because I wasn't at Evercon, like, both...
Mm-hmm.
both Nick and Gen were at Evercon. I was not. I was sitting at home in my apartment in Indiana. And so I'm reading all this stuff going on, and I knew that Nick was working on the article, so I knew that, like, we were moving forward on that. But I was monitoring Windorski on social media just to see if, what he would do, if I needed to, you know, feed anything to Nick. And I just got so frustrated with him that I just started yelling at him on Twitter.
It was really weird. And, I actually kind of feel bad because you have taken a brunt of his weirdness on social media. He has directed so much hate at people, except not to the guy who wrote the article, which
I know.
Is amazing.
He can't read a byline to save his life. It's if to him, I'm the public face. Well, and to be fair, I did state that I worked for Nerd and Tie when I asked him for. Well, he claimed that also that the Brett from Evercon had her like sent him a harassing email, and so I asked him for evidence of that. Like, I was like, "If you've got an email, forward it to me. Show it to me. Like, how hard is that?" And he kept refusing and kept refusing. And I was like, "Look, I write a website. Like, if this is some evidence you actually have, give us the evidence. Or shut up about it." Because I'm like, it doesn't hurt him to share that then to a news source, except that he refused to, which of course is probably because it doesn't exist. And then he later changed his story. Oh, it turns out someone else sent the email afterwards harassing me. I'm like, you can't just make shit up. Like,
I can't emphasize enough. Well, this guy was a weirdo, and his behavior is a cancer to the con scene.
Yeah.
Evercon did everything right.
Yeah, no, Evercon was phenomenal in this.
I want to give a shout out to the comment section on our video and on everyone who shared the video, including Gail Simone. Thank you so much.
You mean the article?
The article.
There's no. This is the first time we've done anything on video about it.
Sorry, I normally do. Normally, the things I do that are culturally significant are videos. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's so. So the funny thing is, even though this, like, I mean, it wasn't quite as big as our Katsukon story from last year, but because it was so screenshot heavy, it brought our server, like, we killed our bandwidth. And
yeah.
We literally did, like, we're Nerd and Tie is, you know, we're not a huge operation. We're a small site. We get a couple thousand readers a week and, you know, nothing to, you know, write home about. But, you know, it's you're our community. The people who are listening to this, most of you listen to this. There's like five of you who watch the video version, but we love all of you. And
shout out to all you great people
who
like on your comments praise Evercon, because Evercon did everything right.
Yeah.
They're a great con, they're a safe con, and they continue to be a safe con.
But I was going to tell you that I want to thank the community for getting the message out, though, because like it's the reason why I bring this up, that we've only got a couple of thousand readers, and we've got about, you know, we've got a similar size people read the website who listen to the audio version of the podcast, which is way more popular than the video version. Video version will get like 20 views, and I'll be like, yes, but the audio version gets many listens. That kind of numbers, we got within a day, like, we went through 85
so
gigabytes of transfer in a day. We normally, and that's not including our media server. Our media is served from a wholly different server that is set aside to handle more transfer. We usually do like 30 gigs in a month. We did 80 in a day, and that's why our site went down, and I had to massively upgrade our plan.
But thank you again, everyone, for getting the word out and for making the con community a safer place. You guys rock.
Yeah, and we want to make it clear that this is a success story. This is a convention dealing with a harasser and doing it right. We're not spreading this story to make you feel less safe. We're spreading this story to tell you that there are conventions working hard to make you more safe, to do a better job, and that if you are at a convention, like Evercon showed us that a convention, you can report your harasser, that they will take quick and decisive action, and they will make that convention mm-hmm. safer for you immediately. When Windorski attempted to re-enter the convention the next day, he was met by police and security who removed him from the premises. This is exactly what every convention should be doing. So to other conventions, this is an example to you to how to handle a situation like this, right? And to those of you who are listening, who attend events, who vend at events, this is a voice for you to say, don't be scared. There are conventions that will listen to you. Report your harassers. Make the place safer. Because if every person who was ever harassed by a guy like this, if we dealt with every situation like we deal with this one, every convention would be so much better for everybody there. And one of the more things that's actually been surprising about this for me is how many people have said, oh, well, I didn't know things like this happened at a convention. And it's usually a guy saying this, like, I didn't realize it was so unsafe. I'm like, this stuff has been happening at conventions for decades. Mm-hmm. This is not new. It's just usually that these things are silent and they are passed by. People don't want to cause trouble. They just quietly live through this without anything happening. And this is the positive movement in the convention scene, that we are moving into a world where we are not afraid to confront these problems, deal with these problems, and handle them properly. And so I really want to like say bless Evercon for doing everything right. And I think that this is a shining example that we can move forward positively.
And thank you also to everyone who did report Windorski at the con. You were very brave. I'm very some of you did speak to me in person. Thank you for giving me statements. But more importantly, thank you for coming forward and making the con scene a better place. You are wonderful people.
And really, best. Thank you for Brittany for giving us permission to share all of everything that we shared.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because it really helps. Like, there are a lot of people out there who had their eyes open because of this event. And it's because she was willing to let us repost the harassment, because there are a lot of people who don't believe it until they see it. And now they've mm-hmm. seen it.
Yep.
So, yeah.
The con scene is safer. Heck yeah.
Booyah, Yakasha. All right. So that was the awfulness. Now let's just move on to terribleness that's hilarious. Phoenix, if anything, has told me that Phoenix, Arizona is a very strange place. It has been the last couple of weeks. And we've got two stories coming from the Phoenix, Arizona con scene. One of these, we're going to start out with a little thing that's been going on these last couple of days. You know, there's a world where if Rob Liefeld is publicly warning you about a con promoter, it's probably not a good idea to work with them or go to their con.
I'm sorry, that's hilarious.
There is, so, Outlaw Comicon, which will not be its final name, as they are now deciding on a new name, because maybe they hurt their brand dramatically in the last week. Is a Outlaw Comicon is a convention scheduled for February of 2018. So again, this is a convention more than a year away. Is run by a comic store called Comics Outlaws that in Phoenix, Arizona. And let me tell you, if you ever wanted to know how not to handle your social media, these are the dudes to do everything wrong. So, besides the fact that Rob Liefeld literally told people cryptically not to ever deal with these guys, which we'll let Rob, mostly because of like some claims that they were involved, people they weren't involved with, and go ask Rob Liefeld is all I'm going to say. And I think that's the only time I'm ever going to say that in my life. The reason why they came to our attention is because being a first-year convention being held in 2018, they have a website up. And on their website, they have pricing down for vendors. Now, an unproven show with no attendance history, usually these cons are a little cheaper to go to for a vendor. Not so with Outlaw Comicon. You see, they wanted for a first-year show with no history, with no guarantee of size, and without a venue booked. Just ponder that for a second. No venue booked. They put up their prices for vendors. Which, again, I ask you, why do you put up your prices for vendors if your venue's not booked? Because part of the calculus of figuring out how much a vendor table costs include figuring out how it impacts the cost of your vendor. Venue. Venue is what I meant to say. But I digress. Their prices were $750 for an exhibit hall booth, $1,000 for a corner exhibit hall booth, or $250 for Artist Alley for a show with no booked venue, with no guarantee of attendance, just a random date on a calendar. Please give them your MasterCard. Because that's right, these tables were immediately for sale on the website.
Oh, dear God.
Needless to say...
Now, all of us buy... all of us have some history of buying artist booths, so
I'm a webcomic artist. I do two webcomics. I buy artist tables. Gen, you make pillows and sell those and do art and sell prints at conventions. Nick, you married someone who does that.
Uh-huh.
We've all worked artist tables. Now, $250, now it's true, a Wizard World show will cost you $250 for a table, but at least you have the weight of the Wizard World Corporation guaranteeing that the show will happen.
Uh-huh.
And I know that anime cons are usually much lower rated than comic cons for that kind of table. You know, it's you, but the fact is that you would pay half of that, less than half of that, to have an Artist Alley table at Anime Central, which has like a 30,000 attendees. These are like five-digit attendee costs for a show with no history, with no venue, and all the venues they're looking at really couldn't support the size of the people. But again, I digress, because what happened next was that a bunch of artists and vendors who had had these numbers shipped around to them said, hey, you might be charging too much. Now, again, this is a list of how to do everything wrong when starting a convention. Now, even when your prices are justified as a con runner, and I can say this as a person who has spent literally 20 years helping run cons, and both Nick and Gen have spent many years working conventions as well, and so they can back me up, that when you are responding to someone, even if your price is justified, which, again, since they don't have a venue booked, these prices aren't justified yet, but even if your prices are justified, if a vendor says to you, hey, this is too high for me, even if you think you're right, you know what you don't do?
Tell them, shut up, stupid head.
Yeah, you don't do that. You don't tell your customer, because again, vendors from a con runner point of view, both your attendees and your vendors are both customers. You don't tell them, no, you're dumb. You don't do it. But
you do that and you're not going to get any vendors.
But you're thinking that like a rational human being. Not Mike Wheeler of Outlaw Comicon, who then took to Facebook. And he posted a diatribe. Again, we have it screenshotted, but in which he, you know, some people are talking about pricing at our shows. Prices are too expensive for a, quote, first-year show. You ever stop to think that maybe that's why shows here ran into trouble? If you can't afford to pay the standard con rates, then your stuff obviously doesn't sell. That's right. Blame vendors for stuff not selling because they balk at your $750 table when you might only have 200 attendees.
Oh dear God.
Yes, you know,
your con sucks because the vendors don't sell well.
Yeah, it's no. Why are people going to pay us to see you? Tell me us lowering the prices is like allowing you to cop to the fact that your stuff is actually good. It is a disservice to the fans. I don't think we should sacrifice quality exhibitors that people actually want to see for you just because you live here. Them's the breaks kid, which tells me some of these people were local. And then, of course, he said, and this is a line that we will we'll come back to in a little bit, what would you rather see at a show? Grandma Eleanor's House of Quilts or the dudes that craft lightsabers by hand. Now, a couple of points here. One, he actually doesn't have the vendors who make handcrafted lightsabers. He's using that as an example. So he's just, like, tossing them on there like they endorse him or something. But Grandma Eleanor's House of Quilts was something he made up. There is now an official Facebook page for Grandma Eleanor's House of Quilts. Created in response to this entire situation.
That's
and
awesome.
I'm so happy that the fandom reacted to this with that. Anyways, this entire thing, like, he goes on and, like, he just, and then in the threads, in the comments to this, and I have them screenshot, he's deleted most of these posts. He's deleted pretty much all the posts I'm going to refer to in this, this comment, but we've got screenshots of the important bits posted online, and I've got more in a folder on my computer. As vendors came back and continued to argue, he would first argue with them for a bit, and this went on, like, and this was January 4th that he made this post, and for, like, a week he was arguing with people in the thread, and, like, just getting mad and janky, and, like, including at a person who makes geeky quilts and sells them at conventions, who took umbrage with his criticizing quilters. But, and it went, and then, like, suddenly went, he just started deleting all the negative comments and banning people from the page. Just wiping it all out. So, that, and then, so I'm just saying, criticizing experienced vendors for your, you know, expecting your con to better reflect the market price of other first-year events is probably not the best way to start out. Now, after this implosion, I want to point out, actually, he claimed to have hired a PR firm. At no point has the PR firm done anything. In fact, actually, currently the PR firm is claiming that they have never worked for him. So it's a little confusing, even though he said he hired them.
Oh, dear.
So, yeah. It's, anyways, to make matters worse, he posted an additional thing. Like, an additional post to the Facebook page. Which starts out, okay, time for another Mike note. Because, of course, we all were confused that Mike Wheeler was the person writing these. We know it's you, Mike. We know it's you. Anyways, it's, he posted, this says, Dear everyone, recently we have started dealing with a lot of low information trolls. You know, because your target demo. Anyways, as I'm sure you have seen in recent updates, says, rest assured this is not darkened or dampened or removed. All the complaints, surprisingly enough, blah, blah, blah. Anyways, to move down to this thing, he said, see, people, what people are not getting is that vendors do not get to make the calls here in regards to pricing and format. I will not allow it. This show is not going to be put on by some rich, greedy, money-hungry, corrupt person. It's going to be put on by me. That's right, a fan. Now, let me tell you something. When you're being criticized for overcharging things, you don't really get to come in afterwards and say it's not money-grubbing. Like, you're literally overcharging for something that you have no justifiable cost for. Just think about that for, like, a second. So, yeah, it's, this whole thing is just, like, it is amazing. Like, and he keeps going, like, so, he talks about his history in comics, and then, like, but he then says in this thing is, no, not one time has anyone in the history of comics asked, well, what exhibitors are going to be peddling crap there? Or, man, I hope I find that button man from last year's show. Okay. So, surprise, surprise. I have, in fact, encountered many, many people whose sole reason for going to shows is the vendor room and who literally follow vendors on their social media to find out what cons they're going to be at and literally have said, I sure hope the button guy from last year is here. Mm-hmm. I literally have heard those words.
We've all experienced that.
Like,
what I don't get is, like,
is Button Bard going to be there? Like, I mean, these are words I have heard people say.
Mm-hmm. What really gets me is, like, this guy owns a comic book store, right?
For now.
So he runs a business, right? Does he not understand that that's what we're doing?
Well,
like, he sees anti-devil's advocate. I don't even know what I would describe this as.
I have to tell you about his comic book store. He's going to be, Comic Outlaws is rebranding, and they're dropping all big two publishers because too many people are buying things online. They're going to still sell comics, but they're going to drop all Marvel and DC.
and make no money. Great.
I was just coming at it from the perspective of, like, the other problem, though, you have there is that comic book, specifically comic book stores, just because someone has a comic book store doesn't necessarily mean they're going to be great businessmen.
No, in fact the opposite is the pattern I've seen.
I was about to say, yeah, in fact, that was... There is a reason I still stay in contact with my old comic book guy from Stevens Point, Wisconsin, from back at... I'll give a shout out to Galaxy Comics in Stevens Point, because they're a great shop. But there's a reason I stay in touch with my buddy who owns that place, is because he actually understood social norms, and he would be nice to new people coming in. And if people didn't know about a character, he would help them find good places to start. For the longest time, though, American comic book stores were run by these socially inept people who would be purposefully...
Many still are. Many are.
They would be purposefully act as gatekeepers against newcomers and would act elitist and unwelcoming to people who don't already understand how the number system versus the annuals or whatever worked for, like, a storyline.
Yeah.
Or where does something fit in with an event comic or any of that kind of stuff. If you didn't already know it, they felt no need to tell you because you weren't already initiated, so...
Yeah, and a lot of those are the LCSs, though, that are having the most problems because they're the least welcoming, so they're not bringing in new subscribers.
For the longest time, you would have these dank, dark places, and those were the only places to get comics, so no one made a big deal about it.
Yeah, and so he's immediately now losing business to things like Comixology, and he thinks it's because he actually blamed piracy in some ways, too, and, like, so he's blaming digital comics for his lack of sales, but maybe it's because people are finding alternatives to him. But you know, the funny thing is that this isn't even the end of the story. This is not the end of the story. So at some point,
of course it's not.
Wheeler came to his senses, and so he took down those two posts, and he posted a Outlaw Comicon a simple apology that respectfully regrets the miscommunications that occurred about our prices and statements were made regarding the artist and vendor community. We at Outlaw Comicon understand that a convention takes a variety of talents and people to make a successful convention and didn't mean to offend. Again, we would like to emphasize that no pricing is final or to be used as what is to be expected going forward as of yet. Now, I know it says something about not final, but again, he's taking money, but since we wrote the article, I have found out more about this statement. This was not written by his PR firm. This was not written by him. I mean, he posted it. Mike Wheeler posted this to the page. But this was written by a vendor who had been criticizing him, who was trying to help him correct. And this text, and I've seen the screenshots of the message sent to him, this text was literally sent by a vendor to Mike Wheeler word for word as an example of how he should apologize to get out of the dirt. Because when he posted this, we all were all kind of optimistic. Sort of. Except at the same time that he posted this, the reason why no one bought it as sincere is simultaneously while posting this, Mike Wheeler showed up in the Rate That Comicon Facebook group, and I'm realizing that I am that our article currently in the version that I had to put back up to save thing actually has screenshots screwed up, so I've got to fix that later. But Mike Wheeler simultaneously showed up in the Rate That Comicon discussion about this, and he posted a message into the thread discussing this in the Rate That Comicon group. For the last 48 hours, everyone has been posting reviews on a show that is not taking place yet, but they're criticizing your costs, buddy. But anyways, after hour 45, I became a little fed up with the trolling. I posted some pretty heated stuff. After all, there's only so many times that people can start picking your words. Except, and he says that like this all happened like within 2 days. The problem with that, and really the key problem with that is that, this didn't happen within the last 2 days. This was a time period of all these deletions and things like that were happening literally 1 week after he posted the initial flip out posted vendors. so that, oh, after 48 hours, all this stuff. No, he spent a week posting this crap. And then when it went viral a week later to the rest of the internet, that's when he suddenly was like, you know, this isn't my thing.
Awesome sauce. Dear God.
Yeah, so let's think about that for a second. Now, since then, since all this, he then the next morning deleted that, posted something to his page that he will no longer be interacting, that they posted to the page that they'll no longer be interacting through Facebook. We'll only be using to post information that was released on the website. Thank you. And then posted someone else's, you know, video about if you woke up inside Facebook, which is completely unrelated to him, and has since pretty much stripped down pretty much everything on the page. But holy crap. You know, there's a weird coda to this in a how not to promote, and like really what I wanted the whole angle of the original story to be before he like went insane was that at one point he actually invited Jim Lee to be a guest, artist Jim Lee, and Jim Lee said no. All right? Which is, you know, you invite guests, sometimes they say no. It shouldn't have been a big deal. Outlaw Comicon made a public post to their Facebook page saying that Jim Lee declined them. And then he said, however, I see no as a show me why I should. Perhaps there's been too many pundits spreading propaganda that Arizona has nothing to offer creators. Let's pundits?
What?
What?
What? It's a word.
So how about it, Arizona? Would you like to see Jim Lee right here in Phoenix? 10,000 likes on this post could very well be enough to change his mind. It's up to you, the fans. You have the power. Like, share, and comment the hell out of this, and let's give Jim Lee a reason to come. Well, first off, Jim Lee said no. Creators like that say no because they don't like it. Also, you know, Jim Lee doesn't want to come. He's friends with the guy from Amazing Comicon, and there's a whole little back feud that we're not even going over there. So, secondly, why does 10,000 likes going to convince someone who said no of anything?
Right?
And
what bizarre? What?
And who publicly shames a guest for saying no? Like, who does that? And then posts a photo of Jim Lee to your Facebook page? Like, oh man,
that's just going to make more people not want to come.
Right?
That's going to tick off Jim Lee. And
yeah, no.
Frankly, why would you want to tick off Jim Lee? He does good art. Right?
Like, there's even more stuff. Like, he went and, so Mike Wheeler went to a Facebook group called The Deplorables. And, like, so, like, the con chair of another con, like, was just kind of being, like, talking about this openly, like, without even naming Outlaw Comicon specifically, but, like, talking about this on his Facebook page. And Mike Wheeler went to a pro-Trump Facebook group called The Deplorables and asked them to, like, linking them to this other guy's status, asking, you know, them to help troll this libtard. Like, literally, this is shit that happened. I don't...
My stomach just churned.
Like, and so right now, Outlaw Comicon is running a poll to, besides the fact that, again, this is a convention that has not booked a venue. They took a poll. People, like 30 people voted in it. And, but, you know, it's like, they have not booked a venue. And you never announce dates until you have your contract signed with your venue. Because you can't announce dates without a venue booked. Because availability! Shit is booked sometimes. Like, oh my God. So
you can't sell vendor tables when you don't have any tables to freaking sell them.
Right. You don't know the dimensions of the room you're going into. You don't know the costs of the room.
You don't know how many people you can bring in.
Like, regardless of whether or not you're counting on vendors to cost for the venue space, some cons do this, and a lot of comic cons do. Like, most anime cons don't calculate the vendor table price really into the space. They use it to offset some of it and then rely on attendee numbers to help offset that. But in the comic convention world, I found more and more cons that that kind of calculate the vendor hall based on how much the vendor hall is costing them. And that's so they look to make their money back on the vendor tables. And I don't like doing that, but it is an industry thing. But you can't calculate what that number is if you don't know how much the vendor hall is going to cost. Like,
I can't.
It's amazing.
I got nothing.
Well, it's not amazing. Let's be very clear. This is in no way involved with amazing conventions. That's a whole other thing.
Like I said, my stomach is just churning thinking about, dear God.
Yeah, just, I don't want to touch this with like a 37 and a half a pole.
So, you know, it's honestly, this is scheduled for 2018. Right now they're looking at renaming the con, so it's not going to be called Outlaw Comicon probably to avoid the very history associated with the moron being dumb. But my dollars to donuts, this convention is not going to happen, period. Because I think his business, like, he's dropping the DC books and running an LCS. And dropping DC and Marvel and running an LCS is, like, his main business is going to go out of business before this happens. And that'll cancel the whole thing.
What really gets me is that, you know, him shunning all the local artists. Like, dude, with prices that, like, high, people are not going to want to fly in because it'll be way more for them to, like, make profits.
Right. All right. So I'm looking at the time code here, and we are running long, so I'm going to move on to our next story, which we'll go through fast because this one's not as much of a tragedy. But we're staying in Phoenix, Arizona. Phoenix, course, Arizona, yeah. Where we are not from. So
sorry, Matt Burkett, my old buddy.
Oh, all right. So
he's an internet person. People know him.
All right. Anyways, so moving on to a different, moving on to a convention that actually happens in Phoenix, Arizona. Let's talk about Phoenix Comicon. Phoenix Comicon is a for-profit show that's been running for a while. And like many conventions, it is staffed by a volunteer workforce that is unpaid. And, you know, it's with for-profit cons. This has always been kind of a legal gray, squishy area. But it's Phoenix Comic Con has been run for years based on the whole thing where you volunteer, you don't have to pay for your badge, and you're done. But starting next year, Phoenix Comic Con will, in fact, actually require all volunteers to begin paying dues to a separate, unrelated social club nonprofit called the Blue Ribbon Army. Now, the Blue Ribbon Army was started as a group of fans around Phoenix Comic Con, but he will require all volunteers to be dues-paying member. And while it's only $20...
I assume they fight Dragon Ball characters in Halo tournaments then, but with the Red Ribbon Army.
No, I figure that they just all... what's the... Blue Ribbon was free speech online for a while. What's the other stuff that's Blue Ribbons with awareness?
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
I'm assuming it has something to do with Phoenix in the fact that this started as a group based around Phoenix Comic Con. While dues are significantly cheaper than actual tickets to the convention at $20, it does mean that any event volunteer now has to pay money for the privilege to volunteer. Now, in an email sent to staff, Matt Solberg, the guy in charge, made a lot of justifications initially, mostly saying that it was about volunteer retention, where people were volunteering and not showing up for their shifts. Now, if it was really about that, there are other ways to do it, such as reimbursement methods. Some conventions, like, there's reimbursement and deferment. So there's some conventions where when you volunteer, you still have to pay for your badge, but then you get reimbursed if you worked all your hours. There are other conventions that you do pay for your badge, but by volunteering, it pays for the next year's badge. And so that also keeps people coming. Because, again, they've got money in the city. Now, if it was just a case of maintaining volunteers, these are much easier structures to put into place. Instead, it's about having them join a whole other corporation. And since we wrote our first article on this, Solberg has effectively come out and said it, that this is why they did it. And it's because there's a legal issue with people volunteering for a for-profit corporation. The Department of Labor says it's not okay. State by state, different judges have kind of swayed different ways. But the fact is that, honestly, if anyone legally challenged it, like it has been done with Emerald City Comic Con, like if anybody actually challenged it with the for-profit, most likely it would become down that they would actually be employees and do minimum wage. And so what they're hoping to do by having them volunteering through this social club, that their volunteers are not technically working for them, but actually working for Blue Ribbon Army, that they would somehow be covered by the nonprofit status where you can legally volunteer. Now, I question whether or not if the people are doing services for Phoenix Comicon, whether or not that can still be considered, even though technically they're members of a nonprofit, would whether or not that would still be considered working for the convention.
I like, do not have the answer to that.
Like it's,
but I got sidetracked by wondering if that con is actually in Oz, that Emerald City one. Because if it's in Oz, I want to go.
It's in Seattle. It's a massive Dang con it. In Seattle. It's the Emerald City.
I wanted to go to Oz.
We wrote an article about this.
I know, but I want to go to Oz more than Seattle. I'm sorry to my friends in Seattle, who I have several.
But Seattle's the closest to Star City that you can go to. Hence having the Emerald Archer.
That's fair, I guess.
All right. So that's pretty much the long and the end of it. It caused a lot of controversy. There's some former volunteers, and there's been a lot of weird drama between like a person who used to work there and the current heads, and whether or not any of it really matters. Like, I mean, it's, you know, there's stuff that people dismiss as drama, but this is really just drama of people arguing about things that all comes down to a basic legal scenario that we just described. And that anything else is superfluous interpersonal stuff, because we're not talking about someone, we're not talking about important stuff for the rest of it. So we could dive into that, but the fact is we're going long, and that's really the long and the short of the situation is that Phoenix Comic-Con's looking for a legal excuse to get out of a situation, whether or not it's actually a solution to their legal quandary remains to be seen. And I think that the courts might not necessarily agree that just because they're technically dues-paying members of a nonprofit, that work that they're doing in support of a for-profit corporation counts as not working for the for-profit corporation.
Well, only time will tell.
And we say this as people who, you know, full disclaimer that the Nerd and Tie Expo, which while we will not be running another one anytime soon just due to a whole myriad of issues, we ran our first convention as a for-profit convention with volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
And there are many for-profit conventions that still do run that way, including quite a few in the Midwest. So, above various owners, like I'm not singling out anybody. Like I know that like some people might think I'm trying to single specific someone out, but it's not just that organization. It's other ones, including, you know, the friends of the show. So yeah, that happened. Yeah. So we should move on to the mailbag.
Oh boy, there's all sorts of stuff in here. This just a minute. Let me get the bag out. You can hear it. Gotta get.
I got my mailbag right here.
The big old bag full of mail.
Oh boy.
I should do more radio sound effects since no one can see me. Anyway. All right. So. We got a bit in the mailbag. First up, we got one from our old buddy Langland, who is one of our regulars, and his subject
Langland!
His subject is, welcome, Gen. Hey, Gen, it's you. Yay. Hey, everybody. So it's 2017 now. Hopefully it'll be a good year no matter what happens, as long as we do our best to stay optimistic. I know you guys have an will have an awesome year, no matter what happens. Two, just remember, I will always have your back. Thanks, Langland. Now, on to business. Business indeed. I am writing to say, welcome to Gen, the newest member of the podcast. I hope she has a good sense of humor and will laugh at written antics.
I really want to point out that, so the sentence is, I'm writing to say welcome to Gen, as in he is welcoming Gen. Not welcome to Gen, like it's a theme park or something like.
Welcome to Gen.
The sentence could be interpreted either way, and I'm fairly certain he means the one that makes sense, but I think the other way is funnier.
You just made me imagine Gen as the Transformer Metroplex. I hope you're happy.
Yay.
Actually, new that'd be OC. Pretty cool. That'd be, never mind. Anyway.
Anyways.
That'd be awesome. Anyway.
Time to draw a new OC.
Looking forward to it. Let's see. If she doesn't, well, I will be sad. No, not really. I have to deal with the other guys, so that don't get my humor already. Oh.
Oh.
Anyway, I wish you, Gen, the best in the podcast, and may you have a long and successful career on this podcast.
I hope so, too, because it's really hard to find new people who we like.
Amen.
And I don't want to have to do that again.
Amen to that. Okay, that's all I got. Have fun, you guys. And once again, wish you the best year at 2017. Smack it out of the park. From Langland.
Sorry, thanks, so Langland, I'm just going to have to say, you've now entered the world where I'm the closest person to getting any sports analogies. And so...
I get sports.
And I still
don't. I know sports.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, not as much as fur.
No, not to that extent, but I know sports.
Well,
sports, go sports. Athletics are number one.
Nick doesn't know anything about sports, so it's just important to remember that.
I played soccer once.
I've seen
that's not
sports
a,
anime.
Yes, because Nick, soccer is so relevant to the majority of sports culture in this country.
Yeah, the two sports I have any knowledge of were I used to play soccer and I used to practice kendo, neither of which are useful in any way, shape, or form.
Oh, we're all in trouble. All right, so I'm going to move on to our next letter in the mailbag here. So, Random Ramblings Man, you sent us two letters. I'm only going to read one of them because you sent, like, half of the letters are the same. I think you wrote us once and then forgot that you wrote us already and then wrote us a second time. Because we're short on time, I'm just going to read one of them, although I might comment about one of them. All right, so Random Ramblings Man writes us, late again, but with good taste. Ironically, this letter came early. Good snowy afternoon, my fellow nerds with ties. Good riddance to the garbage fire that was 2016, probably the most discouraging year I've ever endured. I don't know about you, but I'm hell-bent on making 2017 worth something. With that said, it's time for my contributions for the best and worst of 2017. For the best film, it's a tie between Shane Black's The Nice Guys and the only film that nearly made me weep, The Edge of 17. I saw The Nice Guys. I like that a lot, but...
I wanted to see that really bad, and I didn't.
But I didn't see The Edge of 17 because I'm 36, and they put you on lists when you go see movies like that at my age. Great stuff. Check them out if you can. As for the worst, I almost picked Kevin Smith's forgotten sequel to Tusk, Yoga Hosers, but ultimately I had to go with Batman vs. Superman, the only film that made me feel bad about being a DC fan. Don't feel bad about being a DC fan. Feel bad about Zack Snyder existing. That's it.
I would say Rebirth has been awesome. This is the best time to feel good about being a DC fan.
Anyways, for best television show, it's a tie between Marvel's Luke Cage and the show I almost didn't watch, Stranger Things. Let's just say I'm glad I did. Yeah, those are both really good. Stranger Things got our best pick, so, you know. For the worst, there was only one bad TV program I willingly watched, Gotham, and I still have yet to slog through the other half of Season 3 this year. But I'll be adding Shadowhunters to my watch list as well. Shadowhunters was my pick for the worst TV series of 2016, and I haven't started watching. Season 2 started airing. I need to watch them because I hate watch it. I love it because it's awful. Like, I watched Charmed. I hate Charmed. I love Shadowhunters, and it is so bad. It is terrible. It is the worst thing. I do know he has, in the other letter he mentioned, he actually started watching Shadowhunters, and he said he was amazed I made it through the first episode, let alone the whole season. It's an accurate assessment, but I made it through Charmed. I can make it through Shadowhunters. I've only played one new video game this year, but it definitely was good. Lego Star Wars: The Force Awakens, so much fun. I'm trying to remember. So, for our best video game for last year, I picked Firewatch. You picked the Pokemon game, Nick?
I picked the Pokemon game.
I don't remember what Fur picked.
Game. Don't. It was that knock. It was the Steam version of the way it's been described to me by some people is if Steam did their own version of Harvest Moon. I think it was. I don't
Stardew
remember.
Stardew Valley.
Stardew Valley.
It's supposed to be really good. But those are what we went with, which I recommend any of those games. But the Lego Star Wars The Force Awakens is apparently also good, according to Random Realms Ban, if you like Lego games. So much fun.
I heard it was good.
All right, so continue reading Random's letter. I got nothing as far as comics and stuff from Japan go. Still need to see Shin Godzilla, damn it. And for conventions, I only went to the Nerd and Tie Expo. But damn it if it wasn't fun, and met a ton of awesome, amazing people. Well, it was nice getting to meet you in person, too, Random mm-hmm. Realms Ban. And hopefully one day the stars will align and we'll be able to do another one of those, just not in 2017.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, I close the door on 2016. I award it no points, and may God have mercy on its soul. May 2017 be a better year for all. I accidentally read that as like May 2017, like a date, instead of May the verb. But to be, in my defense, it's at the beginning of a sentence with the capital M, and it threw me off. So may 2017 be a better year for all of us. Except the dude bros. Stay random, my excellent friends. See you soon. So that thank you for your letter, Random Ramblings Man. And sorry we didn't have time to read both of yours, but the first two paragraphs are almost identical between them.
Well, I've got the last letter sent to us by Brenda Gibner.
Brenda! We love Brenda Gibner.
Con drama. So, it's been a while, and I'm sad to see that Fur is no longer with you guys.
Well, he's still alive. He's not dead. So, I mean, like, he's still with us in the sense that, like, he's alive.
Got to say, I love seeing my old state of Arizona having con drama after we left the state. It's always fun, especially after you leave them. This Outlaw Con, I really have just been watching it slowly fail. But for Phoenix Comicon, I do care, as I was part of staff at one point, and even a panelist. I do see where they were coming from, as I was manager for a couple other cons, so I know it's hard when you don't have people that show up. While I don't live in Arizona anymore, I will still support PCC no matter what.
I will say, I was workforce manager for years for No Brand Con, and I've done that job for lots of stuff. You know how you make your volunteers show up? Actively police your volunteers. You take people's badges away. You scare the shit out of them. You scare them. It's not hard.
You walk around with a giant stick and threaten them.
People show up for shifts when I'm running the show.
Oh, dear.
Yep.
Sorry. Interrupted you again?
No, it's cool. You're an intimidating person. In person.
But is there more letter left?
Nope.
Okay. Yeah, no, it's a, you know, it's Phoenix Comicon. I understand where they're coming from, but it's kind of the way they're handling it is messy.
It's just weird.
The fact is that, like, so when you're doing things as a for-profit show versus a non-profit show, and I don't want to sound like I'm harping on for-profit shows, but the fact is that you are volunteering for a company, and if a company can't make money paying all of its workers, then, you know, it's... Meanwhile, like, you can get paid running a nonprofit con. Like, heads of nonprofit cons can get paid. So if it's a matter of, you know, wanting to do something for a living, it's you can draw a salary. And yeah, the tax situation's a little more complicated, but with an event of that size, I don't see why you wouldn't go that route of reincorporating as a nonprofit long term, and that way, you know, if you're in, but you know, it's stuff. It's all complicated because there's been like this massive stigma for years in the convention circuit between nonprofit con runners and for-profit con runners. And it's like nonprofit cons have always kind of looked down on for-profit cons as purely money grabbing. And we know that's not the case. We know there are for-profit cons that are run by fans who love the fandom and are doing their best. But the fact is that it is a legal situation. It's a legal situation where, you know, people volunteering for for-profit companies, it's an issue. So, I mean, honestly, with the best thing to do, honestly, if I was going to restructure a convention like that, if you're a for-profit convention and you want to, like, keep a cut, what you do is you form a nonprofit corporation to run the event that is a social club. You have members, and you have, you know, either a social club or a 501c that you have members, you run the event and they run the convention, and then you hire a for-profit, then that nonprofit can hire a for-profit company to manage certain parts of it, like vendors. Now, does the for-profit company get less of a cut? Yes. You're not going to make as much money as a showrunner. But it does mean that then the for-profit arm of the convention is not the one overall in charge running the workforce. There. I solved it. Sorry. Anyways, we should move on to the Vomit Hat Steve Challenge.
Indeed.
All right.
The Vomit Hat Steve Challenge, of course, is the last part of every episode. And we're getting to it. We've got 5 more minutes till we start getting into, like, longer than the episode can, like, should be territory. As we're an hour and 40 minutes. Okay.
Speed run it.
All right, so the Vomit Hat Steve Challenge is the part of the show where I read a part of a book, and the challenge to you, the listener or viewer, is to guess what book I am reading from. If you guess the book correctly, you get included in the Hall of Awesome. The benefits of the Hall of Awesome are as follows. You get your name read aloud every episode and get your name listed on the website. If you want anything else, too bad. That's all we can afford. The current members of the Hall of Awesome are as follows. Arkham Azero, Rene Senti, Cheesy McDamu, Christos, Slitheridi, Shameless Otaku, The Random Ramblings, Man, Corfan, Capito, Chris Graham, Lilisaurus, Paper Godzilla, Cavsy, The Minnesota Librarians, and Sean Orange. And now for the last few episodes, we've been reading from the same book, and I'm going to now pick a random sentence from that book and read it to you. The sentence is as follows. These speeches, suggesting some slight eccentricities in the regulation of Mr. Green's household, seem to offer hope of an explanation. If you know what book that's from, go to nerdandtie.com/contact and fill it out in the form. Or if you have anything else you want to say to us, what we look like, why Gen is awesome, why Nick is awesome, why Trey needs to really take it down a step and not drink quite as much caffeine, you go there and you write it in. You fill it out. You do your thing. You follow your dreams. You follow your heart. You follow your soul, mind, body, everything that happens to go one foot in front of the other. In case you're going backwards, then do it the other way around. And fill out the contact form. Okay. That is a thing that happened right there. Okay, so I managed to do the Vomit Hat Steve Challenge in less than a minute and a half.
I approve.
That was... And I think that was pretty understandable.
Oh, yeah. No, that
worked
good.
Out pretty well. All right, so that draws us to the conclusion of our episode, of course, though. And, you know, remember... You can always subscribe to us on Stitcher, on iTunes, on Google Play, on anything that can take an RSS feed. You can jump in on there. You subscribe to us on YouTube since we are doing videos again. And because I fixed my computer, the video problem shouldn't happen anymore. I am and have always been Trey Dorn.
I will and might tomorrow still be Nick Izumi.
I think I'm Gen Prock.
And this has been Nerd and Ty. So your catchphrase, Nick?
Keep on spocking in the free world.
Good, because like we totally lost that the earlier episode. And, oh my god, man. All right, so.
It went long, but it was a good episode anyway.
All right, let's end the thing. Oh my god, where's the stop button?